First of two in a series. This is a session that's about Canvas quizzes. And let me introduce my colleagues that'll be joining me for this presentation. I'm going to kick things off and go through a few basic steps about Canvas quizzes. Specifically, we're talking about a comparison between old classic quizzes and new quizzes. We'll be talking a little bit about the differences there. And then we'll be moving into other territory, some more detailed aspects of it that Lindsay Morris will be covering. And Brady Kelly is here to help address any questions that come up in the chat. So as Lindsay and I are presenting, Brady may be able to field some questions in the chat. I've combined them to make them Brandy. So Lindsay and Brandy, you are now Brandy. And so as questions come up, Brandy might be able to hit you up in the chat with some links. We've got a lot of links. We've got a lot of resources to share with you, some of which may be at the end of the presentation. So let's go ahead and get started. Does anybody have any major questions or concerns about Canvas quizzes that they want to broach before we kind of get into the meat of this? Are there any scary things about Canvas quizzes anybody wants to share that they're terribly concerned about, or are you just here to gain some general information? And this is a good point to remind you that I did want to record this session. So I am going to initiate that recording now.
It's already recording, David.
Oh, good. Thank you. I might have just stopped it. Let's see. No, I think we're good.
I just wanted to add, so the question we get the most, of course, from folks who aren't here is about quiz banks and copying quizzes over. So if you could address that so we can direct people to this recording, it would be helpful.
Okay. Well, the first thing I want to mention, just in a very general sense, and I'll go ahead and move on to my first slide here. So we'll talk a little bit about the agenda for today. So we're going to talk a little bit about the differences between Canvas classic and new quizzes. We're going to talk some about what question types are available in new quizzes specifically. We're going to talk about adding a stimulus to a new quiz. And then we're going to talk a little bit about adding feedback to various questions. And then at that point, we're going to shift over to Lindsay, and she will talk to you. I'm going to talk about quiz setting options. Then we'll switch over to Lindsay, and she will talk to you about setting up certain accommodations for quizzes and SpeedGrader and some other information about quizzes in general. But one good thing to point out in terms of differences between classic quizzes and new quizzes. So why are there two versions, and what is that all about? Well, basically, the developer of Canvas decided to implement new quizzes some years ago, and it's been sort of a gradual process. Rather than just get rid of the old type and put in the new type, they have the two of them sort of coexisting for a while. And recently, I think we got word that the full rollover from classic quizzes to new quizzes won't happen for another year to the existing timeline, which I think now pushes us into, I think, 2024 before classic quizzes.
Yeah, I think June 30th, 2024 is the latest now.
Okay, so it keeps getting pushed. So some of the things that we've experienced are, for a time, and I think this has been resolved, new quizzes didn't work with things like Proctorio and other third-party services. That has been addressed, but that was a problem in the early days of new quizzes or earlier days of new quizzes. But the bottom line is there are some more options that come with new quizzes that we didn't have for classic quizzes. And if you're on the fence about it, or if you're at a point where you're maybe redeveloping your course and you're starting things fresh, if you're wondering, like if you're at a new starting point, and you're wondering which one should I go with, generally I would say probably new quizzes is the best way to go, simply because at some point in the not too distant future, that's going to be the default quiz type in Canvas. Classic quizzes are eventually going to be deprecated and done away with completely. Now, again, that timeline keeps getting pushed forward, so it may be a while down the road. But if nothing else, if you notice in the slide here on the right, we've got some key differences between classic quizzes and new quizzes. And new quizzes by transition is just referring to things that have been sort of added to the mix over the course of time as both of these quizzes have coexisted in Canvas. But one of the big things, and probably the big one that I would say is probably the going to be the most impactful for faculty in general is the ease of which you can copy an individual quiz from one course to another in new quizzes. With classic quizzes, it can be done. It's a matter of doing some exporting and importing in particular formats, and it's a little bit cumbersome. But new quizzes, it's basically just a click of a button to push a course or push a quiz, excuse me, into a different course or an additional section. Now, you can still do that by copying your course along with all your content from semester to semester. But sometimes that if you create a quiz in, let's say you've already transferred everything and you create a new quiz in one of your sections and you want to push that to your other sections, that's a really easy way to do that if you have a new quiz. That is to say that it's a process that's very simple to act on. Whereas with classic quizzes, it's a little bit more cumbersome. So let's get into some of the finer points of new quizzes. So I'm going to show you a little bit today of some demo stuff in Canvas Live. Hopefully that'll go okay. And I want to kind of touch on the various different question types that exist in new quizzes specifically. So these are the 12 different question types that currently exist. Some of these are very familiar to you and existed in classic quizzes. Some of them may be a little bit new to you. Let's see here. But yeah, in general, when you're posing the question, which quiz should I use? If you're at the point where you're redeveloping your course, or if you're at that point where you're developing for the first time, or if you just want to redo your quizzes, if you're on the fence about it, I would say go new quiz every time, just because that's eventually going to be the only thing that's left. And that's what Canvas and Instructure are trying to push for. So categorization, let me jump over to my Canvas window here. I'm going to have to exit my slides. Let's see here. So can everybody see the Canvas Quizzes demo course now? If I get a show of hands, or if you just tell me in the chat, make sure I'm showing you the right thing here. Or you can just shout it out if you unmute your mic. Okay. I'm seeing thumbs up, so that's good. Thank you. So what I want to do is jump out here to a quiz that I've already created. And in this case, we've got students who've already taken this quiz. So there's going to be some limited things that I can do with this, because once students have actually been in touch with a quiz, there are certain settings that you can no longer adjust. But I can go in and look at the questions that I've built to an existing quiz. If I enter it, I can go down here past all these settings and go to build. That'll take me back into the area where the actual questions are. And so the first question I wanted to discuss was categorization, which I think I've got one already built here. So categorization is basically ask students to use drop boxes to categorize items that you provide for them. So this course is intended to be sort of a history of the US space program. Excuse me while I hydrate real quick. I forgot to mute, so sorry about that. It's the history of the US space program. This particular quiz happens to be about the Apollo program. And what we have here are two categories that we've created. Apollo missions that actually landed on the lunar surface, and Apollo missions that either were not intended to or failed to land on the lunar surface. And now this one is already created, so I'm going to go ahead and edit this to show you basically how that works. And notice if it's in a bank, or if some student has had contact with it, there are certain options that I'm not going to be able to adjust. But essentially what you do is you create, there are category fields that you can add. By default, there's two categories. I can add additional categories if I want, but I just place some sort of characteristic in each of these category fields. And then I just start creating answers that I can drop under each of those categories to associate with them. The notion being that when a student sees this, they're going to see a bunch of individual items, and they can just drag them and drop them into the appropriate category. And based on that, that will basically address whether the question or not is correct based on how I have this set up. I'm not going to touch too much on essay questions. I do want to point out that with an essay question, when you create it, it will generate an RCE, that is the rich content editor in Canvas for the student. So, and all that that implies. So when a student is responding to an essay question, that is a question type that you will have to grade manually after the fact, but it's also a question type where they are going to be able to do certain formatting. they can embed certain things, certain media. So that is something that I think you're probably pretty familiar with if you've used Classic or New Quizzes at all. But the main takeaway there is students have a lot of formatting options, and you as the instructor will need to grade that one manually. It's not a question type that the system can automatically assign points to. Let's see. Brandy's typing something here. Let's see if I have a file upload question. Let's see. I thought I did, but maybe I don't.
Question one.
Question, well, that would be back here. Okay. Thank you, Lindsay. Okay. So file upload questions, basically, you're prompting a student to respond to a question with some kind of file upload in response to the question. One thing I want to point out about that is that when you are creating that question type, you do have certain options. for instance, you can limit the number of files that a student can upload in response to that question. You can also restrict to certain file types. So let's say you want a student to respond with some kind of written document. So that might be limited to a .docx or a .pdf. you can enter the extensions for the various different file types that you accept, and you can limit those if you need to. But essentially what this does is it prompts the student with a drag and drop area and a browse link. So they can either browse their local machine for the file, or just if they've got, say, Windows Explorer open, they can just select the file and drop it into that area in the exam in response to that question and upload that file to you. excuse me. Any questions about any of this stuff so far? Some of it may be very, very familiar, but others maybe less so.
While we wait to see if there's any questions, I do just want to jump in here. Question number two, David, if you'll show that one. So this is a hotspot question. It's really great because you can have a student identify a particular area on something. So say if you had a picture of a cell and you need them to identify a part of a cell, they can go and they can click on that and show that they understand where that's located. I will say that this is the only question type that is not considered accessible. So if you have a student who is relying on, say, keyboard navigation, they won't be able to use this type of question. So if you are going to use a hotspot question, you have to be very careful and make sure you know your population in your class, if they have any SAR accommodations, anything like that. But all of these other questions that David has gone through are keyboard. Like, you can use your keyboard to navigate. They're great. You just have to be careful with the hotspot.
Thank you, Lindsay. And yeah, hotspot questions seem real cool, and they are pretty nifty in that, you know, you can have something other than text to engage your students. However, as Lindsay points out, that's one of those question types that is generally not considered accessible. So if you do include a hotspot question in your course, in one of your quizzes, make sure that you have some sort of alternate plan for those students that might not be able to access that hotspot question as other students would be able to. Let's see here. So we have fill in the blank questions, which are pretty straightforward. Oh, you know what? I meant to look at my time on this. How are we doing on time? We've got about 40 minutes, so I better speed it up here. Fill in the blank is pretty familiar territory, I imagine, for most of you. Just keep in mind that when you have a fill in the blank type question, it is a blank field for your students. And so there are things that you can do. So for instance, the correct answer on this question is intended to be Apollo 17. There are certain settings that you can apply to accept other variations, potential variations on that answer. Pam, it looks like you might have a question. I'm going to give you a second to type that in here, and we'll come back to that. The actual presentation of this question to the student is just going to be a blank field that they'll then fill out and submit in response. Let's see here. Pam, did you have a question? Did you want to raise it? Okay, if you decide that you've got a question, just you can raise your hand and we can listen to that, or you can just pop it in the chat there. Let's see here. Formula questions. I don't think I have any in this particular test, but or this quiz, I should say. But if I wanted to add another question, I could just click the plus symbol here and I could select formula. And essentially, it's just what you might think. It's the ability to create a question based on certain parameters. Basically, you're establishing one or multiple other variables that you can input. And let's see here. Oh, that's duplicating, my bad. I'm going to skip that one for now because it's giving me difficulty. But if you have questions about formula question type specifically, Brandy, maybe if you can plug a link in the chat there for that one, or we can come back to that. If it's something that you need to know about, that might be more of a certain discipline sort of question. But if it's something that you have questions about, we'll address that when we have more time, or we'll do that offline. Lindsay already brought up hotspot questions. Essentially, you upload an image, designate the correct answer by highlighting an area. But again, that is not an accessible question type. So if you do end up using that, be sure to provide an alternative to your students that might be dealing with certain limitations. Let's see here. And let's see, matching questions, probably pretty familiar territory. Essentially, I don't think I've got any in here. I thought I did. But essentially, you create a matching question by entering certain question and answer pairings. And basically, you just end up with two different ordered lists, and you associate one from one list to the other. It could be, what's an example of a good matching question? I don't like a, if just as a for instance, if you wanted to match the cities of the U.S. or Canada that have a hockey team with the that team's mascot, you would create a list of cities on the left, a creative mascots on the right, and as you create that question, you would line those up correctly, and then as your student sees that pair or that two those two lists, they will pair them up accordingly and be graded according to how your configuration matches their responses. But they don't see everything in order by default. They're going to see basically two mixed up lists and then asked to match them up. I'm pretty sure that's pretty familiar territory for most of you. Let's see. There are multiple answer questions. And let's see, Lori says, Brandy's responding to Lori about fill in the blank. Good deal. Are they case sensitive? I don't know off the top of my head, Lori. That's a good question. Okay, yeah. So in terms, yeah, because there are in cases where there are proper nouns involved, yes, there are probably sometimes where you might want to make it case sensitive. So it looks like the instructor has that option. Multiple answer questions, just like it sounds, when you have a question that includes more than one correct answer, that's essentially what we're dealing with in multiple answer. A common occurrence is that people can confuse multiple choice and multiple answer, not necessarily because they don't understand the question type, Excuse me. Oh, sorry. Voice is failing me here. But it's not necessarily because they don't understand the question type. It's just because they both start with multiple. So as you get going and you're building your quiz, it's easy to mistake one for the other. But keep in mind that multiple choice generally is one correct answer among many, whereas multiple answer, you've got checkboxes for multiple correct answers among many. So keep in mind that distinction. Let's see here. We do also have numeric questions, which I don't think I built one in this particular quiz. But what that would look like, you put in a question stem, and then you basically have a response with a margin of error. So basically, numeric questions require a student to type in a number as a response, and the instructor has multiple options for how that answer must be submitted to be considered correct. Let's see here. There is also a question type that's sort of similar. Let's see here. Where is it? Oh, I guess that's... I guess I'm mistaken. I was thinking of something else. Let's see. We have ordering questions. Did I cover this one yet? Ordering questions. Basically, they ask a student to drag and drop items into a specific order, as the name implies. So it could be chronological order, an order of steps in a process, something along those lines. And then you have your standard true or false questions, which are so run of the mill, I don't think I'll even bother with that given our time frame here. We're already almost at the halfway mark. Any questions about anything so far? Okay, so then what I want to do next is move on to adding question stimulus. So basically, when you add a stimulus to a question, it gives you the ability to add text or images, graphs, maps, infographics, video charts, and more, so that you can actually prompt your students not just with the question type itself, but maybe a little piece of information. For instance, if I wanted to include an image and maybe a paragraph of context, I could create a question type that goes, that's appropriate. It could be any one of the question types that I have the option to choose. And I can add the stimulus to basically prompt my students and give them a little bit of context about the question if I choose to do so. So the way that you can do that in Canvas as you're creating your questions, if I edit a single question here, let's see here. Let's see, can we do this for, let me start a new one. So let's say I'm going to start a true or false question. So here, when I go to add question stem, actually, where is this? Sorry, bear with me a sec, folks. All right, Lindsay saved me. Okay, so when you start to add the question type, there is an option down here to add a stimulus. So this should present you with, let's see here. So this should allow us Here we go. Okay, so we can give our stimulus a title of in certain instructions. The content of the stimulus presents us with a rich content editor. And then we can apply this to different questions in the exam or in the quiz. Discard that for now. So I did want to talk a little bit about adding feedback to questions, which is our next topic. Before I hand it off to, actually, I got to get through this real quick before I hand some stuff off to Lindsay. As you are creating questions or editing questions, there is a little field down at the bottom. And maybe this isn't the best example. Maybe I can find. Let's do this one. Oh, that's also in a bank. So in any case, there will be a little icon that looks like a talk bubble, like you'd see in the funny papers. And if you click on that, that'll bring up this area where you can apply student feedback. You can do this for individual questions, or you can go through your entire quiz and do this for every question. But it's at your prerogative on a question by question basis. And what you basically have the option to do here is provide feedback for a correct answer if you want to do some positive reinforcement. And you are not limited to just text. So you do have a rich content editor. So maybe you can, if you want to include some media, an image, if you want to include a video response, those potentially could be valuable ways to interact with your students in an asynchronous capacity. But you can add responses for correct answer, give feedback for a correct answer. You know, you did great. This is what I wanted you to learn, whatever. For an incorrect answer, you can tell them, depending on what you want to tell them, you might indicate that they missed it for a particular reason. You might indicate what unit of the chapter of the textbook they can go in to review this information so they can get it right another time, maybe on a comprehensive final, for instance. And then you also have the options to provide general feedback regardless of the answer. I'm not sure what that could also be an example of. This was covered in, you know, X chapter, or whatever other kind of details you might want to convey for a particular question. But again, that can be adjusted on an individual question basis. And then finally, I want to talk a little bit about some quiz setting options in new quizzes. Let's see here. I am going to, I think, try to edit an unpublished quiz to try and do this. Let's see here. Oops. Okay, once again, I had to have Lindsay save me there. So when you go into, let me back up and do that again for everybody who might not have missed it, or who might have missed it. So if I'm in a quiz, what normally in a new quiz, when I'm going to build questions or add questions for the first time, I go to this build option. Or if it's a quiz that I haven't published yet and I'm still working on, I go to build to actually add my questions. This is also where we can go to settings. Now, this area might not be visible if the quiz has already been contacted by students. That is, if they've already had contact with the questions and started responding, these settings typically will go away because the notion there is that it's designed such that you can't alter things after the fact once a student has had contact with the exam. But before you publish it and before students have actually gotten in there to take it, you can do things like set the option to shuffle questions, which basically shuffles all of your questions in a random order. You can shuffle answers. One thing about shuffling answers that I would call attention to or warn you about, in some cases when you have multiple choice questions, some people do all of the above options. That's not going to make a lot of sense if you start shuffling answers because the all of the above doesn't necessarily refer to anything above it. So keep that kind of thing.
to jump in on that as well, if you really want your answer shuffled, but you have some of those, all of the above things, you can do this on a question by question basis as well. So if you have one specific question where you want those shuffled, you can turn it on for just the question instead of applying it to the whole quiz as well. And you do that when you edit the question itself.
Thanks, Lindsay. Let's see. So you can display questions one at a time. There are certain situations where this is recommended. For instance, if you're using a stimulus, I think generally for if you're uploading file responses, those are instances where you might want to have your questions display one at a time, simply because, for instance, with the stimulus, your question is potentially going to have a lot of screen real estate taken up with images or blocks of text or whatever, or the combination of the two. And that's in addition to the question itself. And if you have a lot of those, or if you have a lot of, let's say, stimulus with a combination of matching or ordinal questions, those tend to be long lists and might create a situation where your students are scrolling for a long time through a bunch of different questions and answer options. And if you want to spare them that, and generally when you have a question that takes up a lot of screen real estate, that's recommended, you can display your questions one at a time. You can require a student to have an access code to access the quiz. You can set a time limit. You can filter out certain IP addresses. I'm not sure of too many instances where faculty would want to do that, but that there might be scenarios where we can consult with IT to see if we can address that kind of question for you. Generally, that would ban students from certain areas altogether. It might be a certain region, it might be a certain server somewhere. Probably you won't have cause to do that very often, though. You can allow for a calculator, and as Lindsay pointed out, some of these settings you can adjust on a per question basis. That is one of them. You can allow multiple attempts potentially. If you're not necessarily concerned about a student having just a single attempt, you can allow for multiple. And you can restrict the student result view. And if I select this, there are certain other settings that I can adjust. So for instance, this is basically showing them what they would learn at the end of the quiz after they got their results back. I can show them their points. I can show the points possible. I can show both items and the questions. And if I select this, there are certain other things that I can kind of indicate depending on what my other settings are. So that is something that you might want to keep in mind when you're trying to determine what your students actually see once they have submitted the quiz. Let's see here. Are there any questions about anything that I've covered, or is there anything that I've missed in particular that you guys were curious about in terms of new quizzes specifically? Okay, well, in the interest of time, then, I'm going to turn things over to Lindsay. She's going to pick up with accommodations for quizzes. And if you think of anything from that first section that gave you, that led to other questions, feel free to pop them in the chat, and maybe I can try and address those as Lindsay progresses through the rest of this presentation. Lindsay, did you want me to stop sharing, or shall I just bring up the slides? I think you're muted, Lindsay.
All right, all that clicking to fix my monitors. I accidentally clicked the mute button. All right. So we're going to get started with accommodations in new quizzes, and I'm probably just going to stay here just within our slides for now. And then if we have questions in the end, we can go navigate through Canvas as well. But this screen right here should look familiar to you. This is the build screen that David was just working in inside of a new quiz. So you went to build, you'll notice there's the settings tab where he just was, but a couple over, we've got the moderate button. So when you click moderate, you're able to apply specific settings to specific students within the quiz. So you have moderate, and you have accommodations, and these are both located right there together. So if I choose a student, so you see Brandy is my sample student here. If I choose to moderate her quiz, I get this option right here, where I'm allowed to give her additional attempts, and I'm allowed to adjust the time that she has in her quizzes. And then over here, I've got accommodations. I can also change those time settings there as well. The nice thing about new quizzes is that these settings are going to stay with your students within your course. So if I do this for Brandy on this quiz, it's going to stick with her. So if I'm trying to make sure that I meet my SAR accommodations for Brandy, I know that I've got that covered. Let's see. So in classic quizzes, you get there a little bit differently. So you open up a classic quiz, just like you're going to edit. And over on the far right hand side, just above SpeedGrader, you've got moderate this quiz. And here you would just click on the pencil. So you can see I've got the list of names here. I'm going to click on the pencil. And I'm able to give her extra attempts or extra time here. You also have the option, if a student does get an extra attempt, where you have to manually unlock it. So you can't just go in and take your two tests right back to back. Okay, I saw what I missed. I'm going to go get it right now, make sure I get them all right again. You can set that so that students are not able to do that. Unlike the new quizzes, the classic quizzes, you're going to have to do this for every quiz that you assign. So it's not going to stick with your students. Okay, so SpeedGrader. SpeedGrader is where you are able to go in, and David showed you a lot of question types that that require feedback. So a lot of them are going to grade themselves, but we've also got several where we can go back and we can look at those submissions. For example, he had a video submission, so I need to watch that video, or an essay question. I need to grade that essay question. I can go in here and take care of that. So within SpeedGrader, I can see when something was submitted. I can change grades. I can add text, audio, and video comments, and I can use the comment bank. So if you've got comments that you're using in other assignments, you're able to access those here, so you don't have to spend the time typing out the same comments over and over. If you have a really great answer and you've got a comment bank that was like, hey, really well thought out answer, this was really great, you don't have to type that out each time. You just hit that and it does the work for you. So here, this is a screenshot of a grade book. So I've got my assignment right here. It was demo quiz 2, and I've got these three dots. So this it's called an ellipses. When I click on the ellipses, I get all of these options, and then SpeedGrader pops up. So I just click on SpeedGrader, and here's where I'm able to give feedback. This was the quiz that was submitted, and I just scroll through, and I can see each of the questions that were answered. And as you can see here, I've got the grade option right here. I can make those adjustments. So this was a 75. I could give a comment in this box right here that says something like, hey, you know, this was a great try. Let's take a look at our notes and see if we can find, you know, this, this, and this. And that would be just a comment over the entire assignment. But if I go back over to the left where my questions are, I have the ability to give feedback on each particular question. So this obviously was just a, you know, a silly question, which is incorrect. And we picked not this one. So I could click on this little the little bubbles right here, and I could type in, hey, trust your gut next time. And that feedback would stick with that question, so that student specifically knows, hey, for question number one, I really just have to trust myself and go with what I think is the right answer. We need to be giving our students individualized feedback. So going through SpeedGrader allows us to easily and quickly give them that individualized feedback that is just for them. Okay, so I know Allegra brought this up at the beginning of the webinar, and it's item banks and question banks. I'm going to talk about both of these for just a second, and then and if you have questions, guys, type them in the chat and we'll definitely take care of those. But I'm going to talk about both of these individually, and then we'll come back and talk about how do we get from one to the other? So item banks are specifically for new quizzes. Like David said, classic quizzes will eventually go away. We have no idea when, because Canvas keeps telling us, hey, just a little more time. Hey, just a little more time. But the time will come that we're not able to use those anymore. So if you have a set of questions that you want to keep and you want to carry them with you, it's easier to just do it in new quizzes now. The conversion is not simple. So item banks is an option that you can add to your navigation menu on the left-hand side of your screen. You just go into your settings and you're able to drag that up. Just like you rearranged all of these to meet your course requirements, you just pop item banks up there and you have quick access to that. You also can go into build a new quiz. And right up here where you have all these other options that we've talked about, you'll notice the item bank option. You just click on that. You've got the little piggy bank. And then the screen down here at the bottom is what's going to pop up. So I can access banks that I've already created. And from here, I can also create a new bank. I can also just build a quiz and then go through and add all of them right from the quiz. So I don't even have to come in this way. I can add it straight from a question and create a bank that way. Let's see. So question banks is the classic quiz version of this. So in order to get to a question bank, I'm going to go to my quizzes page and the ellipses, the three dots up in the right-hand corner. I click on that and then I get my manage question banks. And then those are going to pop up. It's going to look similar. And then from here, I can also add a question bank and edit those existing banks as well. So if you had courses that you brought in from Blackboard in the fall, and you have all of these classic quizzes now, and you've got your question banks all set up, and you want to start using these new quizzes, this is where it gets a little more complicated. In order to take a question bank and turn it into an item bank, you're going to have to create a quiz, a classic quiz, that has all of those questions in it. So outside of the question bank, you've made a quiz that has all of the questions there. We then have to convert that classic quiz into a new quiz. So it's migration, and we can walk you through this. This is not something that we would expect you guys to just right off the bat go and do on your own. You can reach out to the ID team and we're happy to walk you through this process. But you migrate that from a classic quiz to a new quiz. And then once you have that new quiz, you then go back in. Thank you for that code. Going back and forth is confusing. Once you have it set up in that new quiz, you're able to then create your item banks that way. But basically, you have to break your question bank down into a classic quiz, convert the classic quiz to a new quiz, and then build your new item banks. We do have a couple of videos that on that as a team. So if you want to see that process, you can reach out to us. You can set up a time with us. We're happy to walk you through that process. But like we've said multiple times, if you're wanting to get into new quizzes and you're eventually going to have to, you want to start doing that process now. Okay, so I talked through quite a bit, very quickly. So let me just show you a couple of those things outside of the slideshow. So let me look. So here in my sandbox, actually, let's go here to the gradebook. So I just want to show you how I got to SpeedGrader. So here I am in the gradebook. You can see I have some quiz attempts. So I'm just going to click here. And then, guys, type in your questions if you have them. I know we've got a few extra minutes, so that's why I'm going to go through and walk through a few of these things outside of the slides. So my ellipses, SpeedGrader. And then here's where it pops up. Actually, it says this one, the student doesn't have a submission. So you'll notice on the gradebook side, Brandy hadn't submitted anything. So I'm going to pop down to my attempt. And here I can go through and add those comments. Oh, look, on this quiz, I selected the wrong thing. But I can add comments for those. And actually, you'll notice here I'm in a classic quiz. But I went to the gradebook, clicked the ellipses, and got my SpeedGrader that way. Any questions? Or I can walk through some of the other things that I did. Just let us know in the chat. couple people typing. Okay, Natalie asked if there's a way to show which quizzes you've already manually graded and which you have not. I have not had a student population in my demo quizzes large enough to test that yet, so I'm going to find that out for you. Okay, so I did just get the answer to that. When you're in SpeedGrader and you have the dropdown, it will show you what's already been regraded. It'll also warn you if you've regraded it and you're changing the answer. It'll ask you if you'd like to replace the grade that you've already given. That's a great question, and I apologize. Like I said, I just haven't had enough students in my sandbox courses to come across that yet. All right, and it looks like David also put in the chat our ID Connect email. So that is going to send you to our ID inbox, and then we just go through those and help you as those emails come in. We also have a request form if you want to give a little information right there. Also goes to a location where we just go through and pop in those answers. If you have questions specifically about something David and I or I said today, you can also email us directly. I think you can still see my screen. There we go. Okay. Yeah, if you don't have questions right now and you think of anything, please just email us and we're happy to help. And it's one of those things, definitely, once you get in and start building your quizzes, you might come up with something, and that's what we're here for.
Folks, if you folks will hold on one sec here, I do have somewhere a resource to share with you. So I'll plug that in the chat in just a moment here. Okay, so this presentation is a variation on one done by our lead instructional designer, Kim Estes. And I have included a link to that original presentation, which has a lot more detail than we were able to cover today in the hour allotment. And there's a lot of links to great resources, some of which link directly to various topics within the Canvas instructor user guide. So please check out that presentation. And if you have kudos to offer for that, direct those to Kim, because she's the one that originally developed this presentation. We just kind of did a slap together last minute version of it. So forgive us if it's not as polished as it could be. It's a busy time, as you can imagine, and I'm sure you all are experiencing firsthand as well.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. We'll hang out here for a few minutes. If you think of any questions. Otherwise, thank you guys so much, and I hope you have a wonderful day.
Yes, and thank you, Lindsay, for helping me along where I got stuck. Lindsay is great that way. just to reiterate, we'll be here for the next couple of minutes while we still have time if any questions come up. And thank you, everybody, for being here today. And, of course, if you think of anything later or if you'd rather just follow up individually, back in the chat, we have links to our ID Connect email address and our help request form. So be sure to and keep in mind that you'll have access to that in your MS Teams chat window, the chat window associated with this presentation. So if you need to refer back to any of those links, that's where you can find them. Otherwise, just look us up in the directory. You can find all our contact information in there. Lindsay, myself, Brandy, and then Kim Estes, our lead instructional designer. If you want to, if you forget how to reach us otherwise, that the directory is always a good way to try. Oh, and one last thing before we break. I just want to say, hey, Pam, it's been a long time. I don't know if you're aware that I was back at TCC as of this past May, but it's me. It's good to see you again. Pam, in response to your chat, I blame my now 19-year-old daughter largely for that. So she's hardly responsible, really, but that's my story and I'm sticking to it. Okay, folks, well, once again, thank you for attending our webinar today. Links are going to be back in the chat in Teams again, so refer back to those. And if you have any questions to follow up, be sure to reach out to us as you need to. And thanks again. And thank you, Lindsay and Brandy, for the assist today. Hey, there goes Lindsay. Appreciate you guys.